All right, got a lot going on here today. We have President Lincoln. We have on the screen our American cousin. And we have here, I'm about to be John Wilkes Booth. And I am going to bring alive in a way never been done before, probably in this classroom, the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. That is not to glorify the violence that was in the event, but it is to teach the event, to give students an experience they'll never forget, and to just really bring alive the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, the five W's, who, what, when, where, and then super importantly, the why. Why did Booth assassinate Lincoln? What did he think would come of it? What actually did come of it? And then we're going to do something super interesting at the end, real 2020, the year 2000 plus connection to 1865. We're going to watch an episode of a TV show called Timeless, season one, episode two, The Assassination of Abraham Lincoln. And we're going to think about if we could go back in time, change the events of that day, save Lincoln, would we? Why or why not? See what let's see how it goes. I got my timer set to start our American cousin at exactly the right time so that it'll go off, or I will enter the room at exactly the key line. Well, I know enough to turn you inside out, you sockdologizing old man trap. So forgive me as I wait for the perfect moment here and deal with the lighting. Just like Booth, I want to get it right. I want to get it just right.
And now, tell me more about your home in America. Yes, I can close my eyes and almost fancy I see a home in the backwoods. Your mother is teaching me the fire. While you and your brothers come in, I'll come in too. And your two sisters run about to their sunbonnet.
There be a man, yes.
And then how we not bustle about to prepare supper. 5 days is on the clock. While your good old mother cooks the snapjacks. Do you know, Mr. Trenchard, I believe you have made me half a backwoodsman's wife already.
I wish I could make you a whole one. You know something, Ms. Baron? You are making tracks.
Big what?
Be gone up an immigrant to the rural state of Vermont. Why, you could live on the mother, Debbie and Ann be there. I heard you not be there too.
I'm afraid if I were there, your mother would find the poor English girl a sad encumbrance.
Oh, she ain't proud, not a mind. Besides, they all see Britishers afore.
I suppose you allude to my cousin, Edward Trenchard?
Well, yes, there was him, and then there was old Mark Trenchard.
My grandfather.
Yes. See, he was a real hoss, he was. As game as a bison bull, and as gray as a coon in the fall. Well, the way we figured it, he got pretty angry at his relations back here. So he picked up and went over to America to look after the original branch of the family. That's our branch.
Tell me, Mr. Trenchard, did he never receive any letters from his daughter?
Oh, yes, quite a few of them. Never read them, though. Just chucked him in the fire as soon as he made out where they come from.
My poor mother!
Yes. See, way we could reckon, he got pretty mad at her because she married again his will and mom. He was always just a rusty, fusty old coot. And it seemed every year he just got rustier and fustier and cootier every fall. See, it always took him in the fall. All this year passed, he come down real bad with the ague. He was so far gone, the doctors, they just gave him up for good. And mother, she ran along and fetched the minister. And while she was out, the old squire calls me into his room. And I heard his voice ringing loud and clear as a bell. Come in, Mr. Boy! Well, I come in. Sit down! Well, I saw that. And he took out a piece. reckon that he had a 3-day fight with the devil for that old land soul. But he finally got the upper hand of Satan at last. The mystery went on his way. The old spider was in the bad business from the game. He was changed from what he was before. He was as pale as the sheet that covered. And I saw his hair flowing out from under his red cap and big old silvery locks. And from his big blue eyes came a pair of tears rolling down his furrowed cheek like a pair of mill streams. And when he spoke, his voice was different from what it was. It was like a whisper of the wind in a pine forest at winter time. Low and all. And he says to me, "Hey, Samoa, I've been alive, sinned, and hardened my heart to my own flesh and blood. But I will not wrong the last that is left. Bring me the light," says he. Well, I brought him this candle right quick. He took that paper I was telling you on, and he twisted it up just as I'm out there. And he took his candle from his bedside, and he took the fire, that paper just as I'm out there. And as he watched it burn slow away, he says, "Hey, Savoy, that act disinherits you and makes my own one true heir, my daughter's sweet darling child, Miss Mary Meredith." And he heaved a great sigh and sank back on his pillow as though he felt relieved. And that was the end of old Mark.
Okay. Everyone just sit down across the screen.
I reckon I'll leave her alone. But there is $400,000 there to sing. Hey, boy, you're a hot.
Just sit
here. That's me. Mr.
Pink and Journey.
If you would, first of all, Haven and Savannah, thank you for your passive participation. One for everybody, please. I'm going to tell you the story of the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and then we are going to do a thought exercise. It's really unique. It's going to take you from the ancient to the present, and I think it's really going to turn your gears a little bit in your brain, and you're going to think about the what ifs of history. So, with no further ado, what you have in front of you is a bit of a follow-along page. But I would really just like you to listen, and I think that you will full well. Oh, dear God, we shot his hat right off. I think if you listen, you will gain all the information you need, and it is the backside that's going to really get into that thought exercise I talked about as well. I swear it's like 40 degrees when I was thinking through this, and now it's like 85 degrees, and I haven't worked out recently enough. Okay, continue. So here we go. The assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Now, what you lived for this moment was an immersion, tiny simulation. It's also over. I am not John Wilkes Booth. I would not shoot the president. It was a role play so that you could see what might have been, what it might have felt like on that night. We're going to talk all the details. We're going to talk all the details of the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. So here we go. So first, let me walk you through a timeline, a real brief timeline. Now, you got to bring into the conversation all the information we've already had about the Civil War. And I think you guys do a pretty good job of understanding where we've been. But so now take it to March 20th, 1865. Your brain should probably place that before the surrender of Lee to Grant, and you would be correct. March 20th, 1865, John Wilkes Booth, our leading man, that's who I was playing, and a team of conspirators or co-conspirators, they had a plan to kidnap President Abraham Lincoln. Tell me, how much have you ever learned about the time that Lincoln was kidnapped? No. Well, he wasn't, right? You didn't learn about the kidnapping because he never was. It was a failed plan. Briefly, what happened is that they basically knew his pattern, his daily, weekly patterns. They knew where his carriage went. They knew where they could probably jump off the road and ambush his carriage. A lot of the conversation about the assassination of Lincoln centers on where we see security. We just have to understand that the security, Secret Service and such was just very, very different at that time than it is today. So Abraham Lincoln riding along in a carriage, reasonably, six people jumping out of a woodlot could overtake the President of the United States and kidnap him. If you're a Southern sympathizer, where do you want to take the President? So to the South, yeah, and specifically they were going to take him to Richmond. They wanted to take him to Richmond. The idea would be that they could trade him for Confederate prisoners of war, maybe even trade him, his life, for a negotiation of peace, right? If you capture the President of the United States, you probably have some power on your hands. That was their idea. Well, Lincoln changes his regular carriage route, and Booth and his conspirators, they're in the woods. They're waiting for the President, and he never comes along. Well, she said, just take the jacket off, man. Just take the jacket off. You handed them out and didn't get one yourself?
Oh, okay.
Mr. Swanson,
yeah.
Can you move Lincoln?
Yes, I will. Okay. You guys know I love my stories. So all that to say, it was a failed kidnap plan. And in fact, because of that, you know, just think about all the small things in your life that you change, and maybe history changes because of it, right? You left early, you stayed late, you didn't go, you did go. Well, Lincoln changes his route, and because of that, he is not kidnapped on March 20th, 1865, something you don't hear a lot about because it didn't happen. But let me take it till April 2nd, 1865. This is the day that Richmond falls. The capital of the Confederacy falls to Union forces. We talked about Jefferson Davis and his crew. Where'd they go?
Deeper south.
Deeper south. Where were they trying to get to? Remember that part?
Texas.
Trying to get to Texas. Where did they get stopped?
Oh, on the river thingy, the
bridge.
Oh, in Georgia.
Irwinville, Georgia. Yeah, they got stopped in Georgia, and I told you the story of Jefferson Davis being captured in a dress. He's called the President in Petticoats. Well, when Richmond falls, the Union Army lights fire to the city. A lot of destruction that's happened in the Civil War so far, right? Well, John Wilkes Booth, as a Southern sympathizer, he's devastated. What makes it even harder for him is he's in Washington, D.C. I'm going to tell you about Booth here in a second, but as a Southern sympathizer in a northern city, what do you think? What do you think a bunch of Northerners are doing the day that the Confederacy fell?
Celebrating.
Lots of celebrating. Flags, red, white, and blue, USA, USA. I'm not sure they would have chanted that exactly. But there's a lot of celebration in Washington, D.C. Booth is all the more angry because of it. He is angrier at Lincoln and the Union because of the fall of Richmond. So his kidnapping didn't work out. And now here he has his beloved South is crumbling. You feel the boil meter rising? I do. I feel the boil meter rising. Brings us to April 9th, 1865, and we've talked about this on and on and on. This is the day that Lee formally surrenders to Lincoln. Lee formally surrenders to Grant. And for all intents and purposes, this is the end of the war. The war is over. Now, there are still Confederate forces out there, but Lee's surrender was the big one. It was kind of the start of the tipping point for the South, where the war was bound to be over. Again, celebration throughout the capital city. Celebrations happening all around John Wilkes Booth, and it just makes him more and more angry. He actually, he witnesses Abraham Lincoln give an impromptu speech from the White House. Back again, got to consider that it's just different than today. The president basically opened a window and started speaking at those who were gathered around the windowsill, right? An impromptu speech. And in his impromptu speech, he gives a sentiment about freeing enslaved African Americans, bringing them equality of jobs and education. Booth, a Southern sympathizer, a slave owner from a family of slave owners, and just downright a racist, this makes him even angrier to have witnessed this speech by Lincoln. Now, Lincoln and Booth crossed paths several times throughout each man's life. Booth being an actor, Lincoln actually witnessed him perform on stage. So there's a couple of side stories where Booth and Lincoln crossed paths with each other even before the assassination night that you all witness here today. So still walking you along, April 9th, 1865, brings us to the big one, April 14th, 1865. Little did he know it, but Lincoln's tiny decision to go to the theater would lead to the end of his life. 5 days, a whole 5 days after Lee's surrender, Lincoln feels that he is finally in a place that he can celebrate. He can relax a little bit, and he decides to go to theater in town. Now, in Washington, D.C. at the time, there were two main theater houses. And when I say theater, I mean a stage play. I don't mean a movie theater like we would think today, but a stage play. One main theater house was called Grover's. And at Grover's that evening, they were playing the brand new, everybody wants to see it, production of Aladdin. A lot of people thought Lincoln would go to Grover's and see Aladdin. It was the new one. Well, instead, Lincoln goes to the other theater house. It is Ford's Theater. He goes to see the play called Our American Cousin. And it is the play that you were seeing, on the screen, Our American Cousin, obviously a modern rendition of Our American Cousin because it was videoed. But he chooses to go see Our American Cousin at Ford's for several reasons. One, it is the 1,000th showing of it. Again, it's an old play. Aladdin, brand new. Our American Cousin, old. Two, being the 1,000th production, that's a nice, Hallmark number. Well, the lead actress, she was being specifically honored in the 1,000th performance. She was a famous actress. She'd be up there with, an actress. A-lister.
Like Jennifer.
Jennifer Aniston. Chandler, what did you say?
I was asking.
Yeah. Julia Roberts. Halle Berry, fill in the blank, right? She's an A-list actor. Her name was Laura Keene. Being the 1,000th performance of Our American Cousin, it was actually a benefit for her. The whole ticket intake from that night, the whole money from that night would go specifically to her. Almost like at your church, you might call it a love offering or a charity offering. It was normal in the theater world at that time. So Lincoln actually wanted to boost the attendance at Ford's for Miss Keene. He decides to attend Ford's Theater. Back to those small choices. He makes this choice of where to attend the theater, and because of such, kicks off the events that leads to his death. This is Ford's Theater. This is the actual theater house. You can see the streets are not paved. There are horses and carriages. It looks dirty. It doesn't look much like you would think of a main street to be. This is actual Ford's Theater. Here's a look on the inside. Now, of course, this is a modern recreation of the inside of Ford's Theater. There is not much photography from the time period of inside Ford's Theater. You can clearly see the stage, right, to the left-hand side of the screen. And then in this picture, where do you think Lincoln was sitting?
At the top,
what do you think that would be called?
President's box.
That's exactly right. So especially being in Washington, D.C., they had the VIP box, and it was normal for the president to make appearances. Again, minus a whole lot of security, because that's just what was normal for the time.
There's a portrait of George Washington right at the center, father of our country. And then there's the American flag drapery around it as well, kind of sets it apart as the presidential box. Perspective on this picture is kind of difficult to tell. It's relatively close to the stage. It's about 12 feet elevated off the stage. So Christian, I'd say you're about 12 feet away from me. We're pretty close to each other. Elevated, yeah, but still pretty close to the actors. And as I'm about to tell you, Booth leapt from the box. A 12-foot jump is a notable jump, but it's not something that's going to just shatter your body. It's not something you need a parachute for. So the setup of the theater is pretty significant as well. This, again, being modern, this is actual Ford's Theater, but set up much like it was on that night. Floor seating, balcony seating, president's box, stage down below. So that's pretty good for perspective. You can kind of see what happened at Ford's Theater from all of that. Here's a couple of key players in our story. Can you believe it's not just Abraham Lincoln's story? Key player number one, Major Henry Rathbone. He's a major in the United States Army, the Union Army. And his fiancée, Miss Clara Harris, not married, boyfriend, girlfriend, pledged to be married. They attend the theater with the Lincolns. The Lincolns, and then, of course, John Wilkes Booth. So I'm going to go over each of them real quick. Here is Rathbone and Harris. What's something that stands out to you? Hair, nose, lack of smile, right? I mean, it's all relative to the time period as they had to sit and pose for the cameras. It wasn't just a magical, fast portrait that was taken. I also think their age stands out a little bit to me. I don't know exactly when these photos were taken, but they are young people, but they I don't know, to me, they just look pretty old. Yeah, look pretty old. Well, these are the Rathbones. Henry, the mister, he's a major in the Army. And I'm going to tell you a little side story about why he was there. He was there that evening because he wasn't. General Ulysses S. Grant, his wife, Julia. The Grants were the Lincolns' first choice for a double date. Right? That's what it was. Let's go to the theater. Let's double date. Lincoln extends an invitation to Grant and his wife. And the Grants decline. Can you imagine declining an invitation from the President of the United States? And your boss at that, right? Leader of the army and the president. Why do you think the Grants may have declined the invitation to the theater? They are worried about what was happening. Well, why wouldn't they warn Lincoln then? It's a good thought. Communication wasn't there.
She was pregnant.
Someone's pregnant. Someone has a baby. Fair thought. Anyone else? They might have went to the other one. That's a good thought. That's not what happened, but that's a good thought. You ready for this?
Yes.
The two misses didn't like each other. Mrs. Grant and Mrs. Lincoln didn't like each other. So Mrs. Grant, Mrs. Grant says, we are not, hear me, not going to the theater with them tonight. Now, they give the basic excuse that we're going to go visit our children in New Jersey. And that sounds better than we don't want to hang out with you. But history shows us that that's the reason. Mrs. Grant and Mrs. Lincoln were spatting with each other. Yeah, all right, so key players again, the Lincolns. Obviously, they're in the box. The Lincolns. Her name is Mary Todd. That's her maiden name, Mary Todd Lincoln. And she is a case study all unto herself, right? You could go really deep about the tragedy of Mary Todd Lincoln. She was known to be manic. She was known to consult spiritualists or even the occult. Some people would say she had seances in the White House. Here's one. Why do you think someone might be manic, consult a spiritualist, have a seance? Why do you think someone would do that?
Because
they're paranoid. Paranoia, some craze. How does one become crazed?
Significant life events
is exactly right. What do you think might have happened to her? The war's a big one. It wasn't related to her parents. What really breaks a mama's heart?
The men died.
She's had two young children die. They have a young child die at age 4 in the year 1850. So I'm sharing that the Lincolns are not immune to tragedy. They have a child die in the year 1850. That's obviously on the ramp up to the war. They have a child die in 1862. In the middle of the war, in the middle of his presidency, their 11-year-old dies of disease. The Lincolns are not immune to tragedy. Just being the president doesn't mean that you don't have a hard life. So the Lincolns do have a hard life. Obviously, he's led through the war. Going to the theater, it's kind of a moment to take a breath of fresh air, right? Maybe we'll just have a night out and we'll get to just relax for a minute. So I just share all that with you to know that, Mary Todd Lincoln, she had a difficult life. She is an interesting case study all by herself, but she's got tragedy in her life that kind of brought her to that. Obviously, she witnesses her husband be murdered, and I'll just take it one step further. She has an 18-year-old son die in 1871. She has three young children die before the age of 18. So Mary Todd Lincoln has had some issues in her life. Being the president's wife doesn't solve those. So there's our key players that are in the presidential box. Then, of course, that gets us to John Wilkes Booth. Could go on and on and on and on. This, of course, is the character I was playing. How'd I do? How'd I do with the mustache, the hair? Yeah. I glue stick. You know, in classic high school fashion, I glue stick this on right before I walked in the room. John Wilkes Booth. What do we think about him, ladies? How does he look? Kind of okay. Sinago's with hot. You're going with hot? Okay. He was a dreamboat. He was a dream. I'll go to this one.
I think
he's
an actor.
That's right.
Yeah.
He was considered dreamy. He was considered good looking for the time. Right? Colorized photo. Yeah. Now, a little bit about him. I already told you he is a Southern sympathizer. He was born in the state of Maryland. What type of state was Maryland? Border state. Yeah. Maintained slavery. Did not secede from the Union. Well, Booth as a person was pro-secession, anti-North, pro-slavery, if you will. Ooh, that's what you say, pro-secession. Anti-North, pro-secession, pro-slavery. Okay, he was all things Southern. His family comes from heritage of slave owning slaves. Now, he is an actor, did not own slaves personally because he did not have a plantation, but he is against the African-American, their rights, their existence as free people. That makes him against Lincoln in all things emancipation. Now, he remained in the North due to his profession, because that's where the theater houses were. He is known to have traveled. He was a traveling thespian. He actually carried his costumes with him. This was a time period where an actor would bring their costumes with him. So kind of off to a good start, you might say. But he did travel, but most of his acting was in the North. He remained in the North for his profession. He's from a famous acting family. But he was the youngest and least accomplished. So what does that do to a young man?
Oh, it hurts his heart.
Chip on the shoulder, hurts his heart, yeah. Here is his acting family. Here are his brothers, Edwin, Junius, and John.
Junius,
yeah. So this is the only time that all three brothers were on the stage together. Kind of interesting that they did actually act at the same time, but they were known more individually. They were not exclusively known as a famous family. What's a comparison you might be able to make today? Famous acting family.
Jonas Brothers,
I'll buy it.
Olsen Twins,
I like that, I'll buy that. The Hemsworths, okay. I'm thinking, maybe I'm older than y'all, I'm thinking about the Wahlbergs. Mark Wahlberg. Little less famous, Donnie Wahlberg. And then probably, pretty much unknown, Paul Wahlberg. So he was basically Donnie or Paul. Okay, he was not the famous Mark Wahlberg. That's Mark on the right in a lot of movies. He's one of the other two brothers that are just less famous. So you guys said it pretty well. Chip on his shoulder. It probably, yeah, it hurts his heart. You know, it hurts his ego that he's not quite as famous. Okay, so that's a good setup to his personality. Here's the how it happened. I'm going to go through all of these. So first things first, the door. This is the door that was to the presidential box. Now, of course, I was exaggerating a little bit as I came in the room, but there's something notable about this door that I'm going to zoom in on for you. First, this is a 7th grade Mr. Swanson, that's right. Yeah. And it's more like Son in Blonde. I visited Ford Theater in 7th grade, so I do have a couple pictures from that. Check it out, but zoom in on this door. What do you see? Can you see it?
Where's the gun?
The door has a hole.
Say it louder. It's not a bullet hole. It's a whittle hole.
A whittle.
You look through it like little people. Say it again, Austin.
You look through it like little people.
J John Wilkes Booth on the day of the shooting, the day of the assassination. Being a theater, he had access to Ford Theater. Right? Being an actor, he had access to Ford Theater. He could come and go. It wasn't that big of a deal, right? He was normal there, in and out. Well, what he does is he whittles a hole into the door so that, so that he can peek in to make sure Lincoln's there. So that he can peek in to see, okay, how many steps is he from me? Is there someone between me and him? It's people. He whittles a peephole in. Very interesting that we still have this door as well. So first big step is the door. Second, the timing. I actually got this perfect. I didn't know if I would, but I got this perfect. The moment in the play that you were viewing is the exact moment that John Wilkes Booth shot Abraham Lincoln. What you saw on the screen was the woman character, right? This is Laura Keene. She's got a big old dress and big old hair and whatever. This is the actual actress. And at the moment in the play was a punchline. What happens after a punchline?
A laugh.
Laughter. And the reason John Wilkes Booth played, he knew the play inside and out. As an actor, and since the play was in its 1,000th run, he knew all the dialogue inside and out. He knew when the audience laughed. So he takes this line that says, well, I know how you turned you inside out, you sockdologizing old man trap. It's not language we really use today, right? But when this punchline was delivered, you sockdologizing old man trap, the audience, without fail, on cue, would laugh. The laughter masked his shot. And his shot was not all that loud to begin with. I'm going to talk about the gun in just a second. His gun was not all that powerful. So what it gave him was a moment to escape. He wanted to shoot the president, but he did also want to get away. So the pop, honestly, guys, might not have been a whole lot louder than those confetti poppers. His gun was not super powerful. Like today, you might need, earplugs to keep from getting ringing ears. His gun was not all that powerful. The confetti poppers may well have been just about as loud as this .44 caliber gun was. And he timed it exactly on this laugh line, sockdologizing old man trap. Ha 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 ha. Boom. Here he is, the gun. Oh, so a bit of a rendition of what it might have looked like. A lot of storytelling about the assassination of Lincoln across time. Yeah. Here is the gun. This is the actual gun. Okay, this is a Booth's .44 caliber Derringer. It's known as a Derringer. Single shot, 5.75 inches long. My gun might be outside. I had a Nerf gun in my pocket, but of course I was using the poppers. 5.75 inches long. Okay, not that big of a gun. Now, here's what's interesting. Booth had access to miniguns. Booth had access to repeating guns, a six-shooter. Why do you think Booth might have chosen a one-shot gun instead of a six-shot gun?
One doesn't look right.
Oh. Why do you think Booth might have chosen a one-shot gun instead of a six-shot gun?
I don't know. He made sure that he had one shot.
That's pretty close.
So
he didn't shoot other people? Actually, if he wanted to also take out Grant, of course Grant wasn't there, if he wanted to take out Grant, he would need more bullets. History believes this, and this comes from Booth's journals. This comes from kind of a psychoanalysis of the man. He was a thespian to the core. He was an actor to the core. And he wanted it to be a dramatic one-shot assassin. Right? Right? This is Lincoln's gun. And that might be the last thing Lincoln ever saw. Right there.
Oh, that?
That's the gun looking down the barrel. Now, no, Lincoln was not looking at it, right? But that is Booth's gun looking down the barrel. And this is at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C.
We should go back. You
can go visit this place. Yeah, that was a summertime. Like, sure. All right, moving on. Now, I tried to replicate something that, of course, the room just wasn't perfect for. The president's box. I said it was 12 feet above the ground. Booth shoots Lincoln. Booth has to scuffle with Rathbone. And I pulled out a knife because that's exactly what happened. Booth used a knife to slash at Major Henry Rathbone. Now, if that had been Grant, and he had killed Grant, he really could have crippled the Union at that time. But, of course, Grant declined the invitation. So he slashes at Rathbone, and then he jumps off the stage. And he jumps off the stage for a lot of reasons. One, to escape, but two, for the drama. I really believe he wanted to create the drama. As he's jumping, Not quite sure exactly what happened, because eyewitness reports are mixed. Whether he got his boot caught in the flag, whether Rathbone tripped him a little bit. One way or another, he kind of lands funny on the stage, and as he does, so he hurts his left leg. Hurts his left leg. So now he's no longer fully healthy. He has a gimp. It goes on to be a sprain or a break, right? Could be a, you know, big sprain or a mild break. But he's not as physically fit as he once was. He now has a leg injury. Well, he jumps off the stage, and there's a variety of art that comes with that, right? I think it's a, you know, there's a bunch of movies and a bunch of pictures that start to tell this story. Jumps off the stage, and he shouts something very specific. What did I say as I jumped off the stage? On the screen there, yeah. Sic semper tyrannis, which means thus always to tyrants. It is his statement that Abraham Lincoln was a tyrant. It is a statement that comes from a Shakespearean play about Julius Caesar. Ever the thespian, John Wilkes Booth is quoting Shakespeare. Just as Julius Caesar was a tyrant who deserved to die, he's saying Abraham Lincoln is a tyrant, and this is why I've killed him. Sic semper tyrannis, thus always to tyrants. Sic semper is the state motto of Virginia at the time, and guess what? To this day. I'm surprised by that. I didn't know that. I researched. I thought for sure Virginia has a different state motto to this day. Virginia has a different, or this same state motto to this day. Sic semper tyrannis, thus always to tyrants. This was a big Southern rallying cry, right? If the North is the bad guys, they're the tyrants. The South is saying tyrants get what they get, right? Snitches get stitches. The North gets what they get. Sic semper tyrannis, thus always to tyrants. Let me make a real modern day connection for you. My world historians from last year are sharing with you the story of the Oklahoma City bombing. The t-shirt that the bomber, Timothy, was wearing had a picture of Lincoln on it, and it said Sic semper tyrannis. So Timothy McVeigh, who bombed the federal building in Oklahoma City in the year 1995, shared with the world history class last year, maybe you remember, maybe you don't, a modern American terrorist, okay, the year 1995, a modern day American terrorist. He still uses this phrase, thus always to tyrants. And the statement he was trying to make, without getting too deep, he was trying to say that the federal government is tyrannical. The federal government is the bad guys. And just as John Wilkes Booth did something to upset the Union, I today, this is Timothy McVeigh in 1995, I today am doing something to stick it to the federal government. So Sic Semper Tyrannis has been a phrase that's been around for a long time. Now what happens after that, eyewitness reports get real sticky, okay? Today, if you wanted to know exactly what happened at a political rally, at a sports event, in Mr. Swanson's classroom, what would you do? Go to the video. How much video exists of John Wilkes Booth jumping from the stage?
Zero.
Absolutely zero, of course, technology. So what we have is eyewitness reports. When you're slightly stressed out and it gets a little chaotic, do you think all 25 of you are going to give me the same story?
No.
You tell me different stories from this 1 minute little interaction right here. So what we have is a bunch of eyewitness reports that don't fully match. But what we can reasonably understand is that he jumped. He said, Sic semper tyrannis, the South has been avenged. And then he ran off the stage. So Sic semper tyrannis, we definitely agree that he said that. He most likely also said something to the effect of, long live the South, or the South has been avenged. So clearly showing his Southern sympathies, clearly showing that he believes that he's doing this for the South. All right, let's get to the escape. This is a portrait, a visage of John Wilkes Booth escaping, and it even has a ghostly Abraham Lincoln watching him as he does.
I didn't
right?
see that.
Woo, spooky, isn't it? So the assassin, it's saying that the assassin has a vision that his victim is following him on his escape. Well, I'm going to give you a long story short. To get out of Washington, D.C., John Wilkes Booth had to get to a horse. He gets his horse right behind Ford's Theater. He hops on his horse. There's a young man holding his horse for him because John Wilkes Booth said, hey, man, hold my horse. I'll pay you a dollar. This young man holding his horse eventually gets arrested for the crime of holding John Wilkes Booth's horse. Was he involved in the conspiracy? But he did hold Booth's horse, so he eventually goes down with the conspirators in the same way. To get out of Washington, D.C., you have to cross a bridge. Guess what? That bridge, all bridges, were covered by Union troops. How did John Wilkes Booth cross a bridge guarded by Union troops?
He just swam.
He just asked. Hey man, I'm sorry, I know I'm past curfew, but I'm really just trying to get home to Maryland tonight. If you could let me across, I'll never do this again, I promise. He just asked, and the guards let him across. Now, they didn't know the president had been shot, they didn't know that there's a manhunt on, but they did violate their orders because they weren't supposed to let anybody across.
So they got
wink, wink, hey man, just let me across. It's just one time, don't worry about it. So there's a lot that goes into that. You know, you could think about what if those soldiers had stopped him. His escape eventually takes, his manhunt lasts for 12 days. I'm going to tell you about that here in just a second. So now the country knows Lincoln has been shot. Lincoln is taken from the theater to a house just across the street. It's called the Peterson Boarding House. It's a hotel, right? Some people wanted to get him all the way back to the White House. But realistically speaking, he probably couldn't have made it on the cobbled streets, back of a carriage, the horse is rattling you along. He never would have made it to the White House. So what they do is take him across the street to the Peterson Boarding House. This is it right there. It's still there today. You can walk from Ford's Theater, where he was shot, across the street to the boarding house, and they actually have his deathbed preserved. They have his pillow with his blood on it preserved to this day. So if that's a piece of history you care to go see, you can go to the Peterson Boarding House. Well, many people gathered around his bed. The whole government comes to his bedside, many members of his cabinet, his wife, his children, and he continues to live until 7:22 the next morning. But at 7:22, like doctors do, April 15th, 1865, his physician pronounces him dead. His Secretary of War, which today we might call the Secretary of Defense, Edwin Stanton, says now he belongs to the agents. He might have said now he belongs to the angels, but what got written down is now he belongs to the ages. And this is a common portrait that came from that time period of George Washington welcoming Abraham Lincoln into heaven, right? The fathers of our country, now they're reunited in death and in the afterlife. So big spiritual perspective that comes from all that as well. This is the bed that Lincoln died in. You want to know what's crazy? It was one dude's boarding room. It was a guy's hotel room. That guy was actually inconvenienced by Abraham Lincoln being there. That guy slept in that bed for the next several months afterwards without like cleaning the room or changing the light. He just what happened in that time period. So the guy who was boarding in this room obviously gave it up for that night, but he continued, he returned to his room, he continued boarding in that room right there. This is Lincoln's death room set up today. You could go and visit it much like it was on that night. This right here is the only picture of Abraham Lincoln in death. Okay, there's a lot of rumored pictures out there of his corpse. And I would discourage you from Googling because you're not going to find an accurate picture. This is the only picture of Abraham Lincoln in death. One set of photographs was taken of his funeral setup. It was actually against Secretary of War Stanton's wishes. He said there will be no pictures taken of our dead president. But one photographer did. When they found out that he did, they actually took his originals and they broke all but one. Because even though they didn't want photographs taken of the dead president, they recognized how historic it was. They broke the glass plates. That's how photographs got made back then. They broke all but one. So this is the only picture that exists of Abraham Lincoln in death. You can kind of see his face. This is how his funeral was set up. Now, he toured the country as he went home to Illinois, and many people got to pay tribute along the way. This is a bugle that was played at Abraham Lincoln's funeral. So just, again, one of my museum visits, I got to see this bugle right there. But wait, there's more, and I am getting to the end, but we're going to watch a video here, okay? So we're going to go over all of these, conspiracy, manhunt, capture, and trials and executions. So initially, word gets out, it's John Wilkes Booth. He's famous, y'all. He's got a big, note, recognizable face. He's Donnie Wahlberg. People know who shot the president. It is not a mystery who shot the president. Well, a reward goes out for his capture, $50,000. Who wants $50,000?
Me.
Guess what? It's, if you adjust it for inflation, it's $800,000. So this was a notable reward. Okay? This was not chump change. This was a notable reward. And there are co-conspirators. And I'm going to tell you about other people involved. Here are the four main, and I'm going to briefly go over each one. This is on your follow-along sheet right here. First, David Harold. Ladies, how's he look?
Who?
Not you? Okay. David Harold escaped. This guy helps Booth escape D.C., okay? He helps him get across the bridge. He is with him for the next 12 days. David Harold is with Booth every step of the way along the manhunt, throughout the manhunt. David Harold is with Booth throughout the manhunt. Next up, and I'll go back if you wish, like we can get there, okay? But help me finish this up. Next up is Lewis Powell, ladies. Ladies, he is very often called the hot criminal. If you look up Lewis Powell on the internet, you're going to see his mugshots and a whole bunch of like hotornot.com type stuff. Lewis Powell is often called the hot criminal. He was assigned on the same night that Booth killed Lincoln to assassinate the Secretary of State, William Seward. Oh, this is bigger than Lincoln. I told you the story of what happened at Ford's Theater. But since Booth could not capture Lincoln, could not kidnap Lincoln, he hatches a new plot. And this plot includes, or is an attempt to, cripple the entire Union. If we kill the president, bonus, maybe we get General Grant. Now, that didn't work out. But we're at the same time going to attack the Secretary of State, William Seward. And that's what Lewis Powell is assigned to do. He knocks on the door. He is greeted at the door. He breaks his way in. He attacks Seward's son. And then he bludgeons Seward himself. Bludgeons, bah, 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 in the bed. Beats him in the head. Seward, near death, ultimately recovers. Seward does not die. The reason they wanted to attack Seward on that night is because he was in line to succeed the president. They thought if they could lop off the top of the Union government, they'd cripple the Union and maybe keep the war going. So this is Lewis Powell. Another picture there. Ladies, what do you think?
Ew.
Still going with ew? Okay. George Atzerodt. George Atzerodt is often described as slow, a follower. He may have even been mentally handicapped. Okay, we don't exactly know what that means. We don't have a doctor's diagnosis. But he was a follower. He was slow. He was just doing what John Wilkes Booth wanted him to do. He was assigned to murder the vice president, Andrew Johnson. President, vice president, Secretary of State. If we can lock these three off in the same night, we might have the Union crippled. General Grant would be a total bonus. Well, guess what Atzerodt does?
Just for one person.
Nothing. He doesn't do anything. He spends the night drinking. He loses his nerve. And he never even goes to the vice president's residence. So Andrew Johnson was never really in any danger. At least he didn't experience an actual attack. Because Atzerodt never actually went to his residence on that evening. This is George Atzerodt. Leads me to Mary Surratt. Mary Surratt is a woman. A woman was involved in the conspiracy to assassinate Lincoln. This is crazy. Mary Surratt runs a boarding house where these conspirators met. She had an understanding of their plans, and she even kept weapons and equipment for them. But it is going to become interesting, the national conversation about how much should she be held accountable? Is she at the same level as John Wilkes Booth and the other co-conspirators or not? Big conversation about should a woman stand trial for her crimes? Were her crimes large enough to warrant the death penalty? This is Mary Surratt. Now, more guilty in the Surratt family was her son, John. And that's an inset picture I just pulled up right there. John Surratt was involved in the initial kidnapping plot. He did not participate on the night of the assassination. He was most likely a Confederate spy and was in Canada at the time of the assassination. So his name gets roped into the story, and he eventually is arrested and charged with a conspiracy. But at the time, he was not even in the United States for the assassination. Leads me to the manhunt. I'm going super fast here. There's a lot to the story. The manhunt lasts for 12 days. It starts at Ford's Theater. It leaves Washington, D.C. Booth's big goal was to get to the Deep South. He felt if he could get to the Deep South, he would be received as a hero. He shot Lincoln. The people would protect him. He'd be received as a Confederate hero. That is not what happens. Universally speaking, the country is aghast at Lincoln's death. The South has almost accepted the loss of the war, and the assassination is seen as cowardly, dastardly, not something that soldiers were facing off in battle, but like this cowardly act to assassinate the president. So Booth does not find support amongst the people. Basically, what he does is he has to cut through Maryland. He crosses the Potomac River into Virginia, and 12 days later, the manhunt ends at a barn in Virginia, and I'm going to tell you what happens there. One more little side thought here. This is Samuel Mudd. Samuel Mudd is a doctor. John Wilkes Booth knew Samuel Mudd before the assassination attempt. On the night that he shoots Lincoln, what happens to his leg?
He gets hurt.
Yep. He needs medical attention. John Wilkes Booth goes to his old compatriot, Dr. Samuel Mudd's household. Dr. Samuel Mudd, after all these events, he will claim he did not know who his midnight visitor was. Knock, knock, knock. Hey, sir, I have a man here who has hurt his leg. Can you help him? Dr. Mudd will claim that he did not know it was John Wilkes Booth. He will claim he had no idea of John Wilkes Booth's plans or actions that he had just shot the president. History doesn't really believe that Samuel Mudd knew nothing, but it's very impossible to prove how much he did know. Dr. Mudd does get charged with the conspiracy, much like all the other participants, and he is sent to jail for his role in fixing John Wilkes Booth's leg. So, big conversation there about was he responsible or not? How much did he actually know? There's a phrase in the world, and that phrase is, his name is Mudd. What does that phrase mean to you?
Mud?
His name is Mud, or his name has been drugged through the mud. What does that phrase mean?
Oh, like,
yeah.
He doesn't have a good reputation.
If your name is drugged through the mud, what comes to mind?
Dirt.
You probably actually think about the dirt, right? My name has been drugged through the mud. Ready for this? That phrase references Dr. Samuel Mudd. If your reputation is under attack, your name has been drugged through the mud, it's not the mud like the dirt. It is referencing Dr. Samuel Mudd. Just like his reputation was attacked, you might use that phrase to say my reputation is being attacked. Now, I know a lot of people think it means they've taken your name through the dirt, but it actually references Dr. Samuel Mudd. Here's some evidence that does point to his involvement. That is John Wilkes Booth's boot. When he jumped, he had his big old riding boot on. Well, his boot had to get cut off in order to fix his leg. Those are Dr. Mudd's tools, and eventually his leg irons that he wears in jail. So some interesting side effects there. All right, the capture. John Wilkes Booth gets holed up at a farm in Virginia, the old tobacco barn. Now, his hosts at this farm will say they didn't know who their visitors were. They will say that they did not get the news. The news reports had not made it. We didn't even know Lincoln had been shot. Okay, that's what this family, the Garretts, says. Well, John Wilkes Booth and David Harold, they are holed up in this tobacco barn when the Union Army comes to call them. There had been a large manhunt going on for 12 days. Remember all the money involved. If you capture these guys, we'll give you $50,000. Everybody wants to capture them, maybe to support the Union, but definitely to get the money, right? Well, the Union Army surrounds this barn. They believe they have John Wilkes Booth on the inside. Maybe they don't know for sure. He has shaved his mustache. He has withered away in his appearance, but for 12 days he hasn't been able to eat or exercise very well. But they believe John Wilkes Booth is in the barn. They surround the barn. They put it on fire. And do you think they want to kill this man or capture this man?
Capture.
The order is capture alive if possible, right? So we can take him to Washington. We can interrogate him. We can learn more of the story. They want to take him alive as possible. Well, what happens is this guy right here, soldier named Corporal Boston Corbett. He claims that Booth raises his weapon to him, and if someone raises a weapon to you, what do you assume they're going to do? Shoot you. So what does he do?
He shoots Booth
through the neck. It nicks his vertebrae. Booth dies shortly thereafter. Booth dies after about 3 hours after having been shot. So Booth dies in the barn. This is Boston Corbett right there. He was not supposed to shoot Booth, but he did. He's not on your page. Some see him as disobeying orders, and he killed Booth when he wasn't supposed to. Others see him as a great hero because he shot the man that shot Lincoln. Well, let's get to the end here. The conspirators are arrested. They are put on trial. Dozens of people are arrested. In the end, only 8 go to trial. And I'm going to tell you about the big 4, the 4 that I've already pointed out to you here. So we have Surratt, Powell, Harold, and Absarok. They go on trial. They are found guilty. they are sentenced to death. Death by hanging on July 7th, 1865. April, May, June, July. A short 3.5 months later, they are sentenced to hang in Washington, D.C., and hang they do by the neck until dead. They hang on July 7th, 1865. These are the only four that die for the assassination. This is a real photograph.
Is that real?
This is a real photograph, yeah. This is the wide shot. This is the close shot. Can you handle that? Can you handle that? These are the conspirators of the execution of Abraham, or the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. They are hanging for their crime. Now, briefly, let me get to an epilogue here. Andrew Johnson, he survives the shooting. He goes on to be president. Grant, he's not in D.C. on that night. Of course, he is upset that Lincoln is killed. He goes on to become the 18th president. And the Rathbones, this is far more interesting than the two guys that go on to be president. Remember the Rathbones? They were in the booth just by chance. They were in the president's box just by chance. They were not Lincoln's first choice. In fact, he went from Grant, he went on down the line of people he wanted to invite, and eventually he settles on this new engaged couple, right? The Rathbones.
They get married.
They get married. They have three kids.
Yeah.
He goes crazy. In 1883, he kills her, and he is institutionalized until his death in 1911.
I think I'm crazy.
Why does he go crazy? Many believe, PTSD, basic trauma. He was a major. He served in the Army until 1870, okay, so he serves past the war. But as families do, they have difficulties. They have marital issues. Long story short, I'm just showing you that he struggled from this night. He struggled from this night for the rest of his life. He murders his wife in 1883. He is institutionalized for the rest of his life, all the way until 1911. So not a happy ending for the Rathbones. All right, I'm going to get to what we're doing next. There's a TV show came out just a couple years ago. It's called Timeless. Follows a trio of time travelers. So suspend reality for just a second. Let me introduce you to the characters. Here they are in the year 1865. You might guess that we're going to go back to the night that Lincoln was shot. This is Lucy Preston. She is a professor. She's a historian. Goal is to preserve history, the good and the bad. So in the TV show, she is always trying to keep history to change. If someone didn't die, she has to protect them. If someone did die or events did happen, she wants to preserve history, the good and the bad. Well, guess what? There's always a bad guy. This is Garcia Flynn. He works for the so-called bad guys. Yeah, and they are called Rittenhouse. Now, there's a couple details in the show that we're about to watch you might not fully understand, but we're just going to roll. You know, you got to roll with those details, okay? Garcia Flynn is the bad guy. Garcia Flynn in Rittenhouse, they are trying to change history for their agenda. So you could get into some deep political thought there, whatever the case may be. I don't know why I keep doing that. Garcia Flynn is trying to change history for their agenda. So you might think about what do they want to happen on that night. Two more characters. Wyatt is the soldier. Rufus is the pilot. Yeah, Wyatt's a dreamboat. So along with Lucy, they time travel in their time machine called the lifeboat. They take on Garcia Flynn and Rittenhouse all across time and history. Well, they travel to April 14th, 1865. Let's see what happens when they cross paths in Washington, D.C. What could possibly go wrong? We're not going to go to the bathroom right now, and you're going to be fine with this, I promise. All right. So, hey, really just watch the show. Enjoy.
Here's a wrestler for one. 300 fights, only lost one.
What do you
do? I'm a bodyguard.
The garden
next door watching the play.
Hey, Mr. Booth. He's been asking when we're going to be seeing you on stage again. Soon. But I'm spilling over with affections, which I am ready to pour over you like applesauce over roast pork.
that you are not used to the manners of good society, and that alone will excuse the impertinence of which you are guilty.
Don't know the manners of good society, eh? Well, I guess I know enough to turn you inside out, old gal, you suckologizing old man-trap. Sic sequitur annis! The South shall be free!
No, you can't just go see.
What the hell's gotten into you? Who's Amy?
I'm sorry. Sorry, Amy is a friend, and she's from work, and she needs my help. Okay? Mm-hmm. Really, I'm glad to see you. Okay. Just don't forget about tomorrow night.
Yeah. So Flynn took out the mothership again, huh? Where'd he go? Oh, no, I just got here.
Hey, what's changed in your lives? Well, since we got back from 1937, what has changed for you?
I just had an unsuccessful evening with a girl, so nothing really. Why, what's wrong?
My sister's gone.
Gone where?
Gone as in erased from history. Something that Flynn did or we did to the Hindenburg has changed my family. My mother isn't sick anymore, and my sister was never born.
Dossier. We have a dossier on you, and it doesn't say anything about her sister.
Look, this is her, right here.
You wore this on the trip back to 1937. Agnes, incredible you took it from a timeline where your sister existed, carried it here to where she doesn't.
I cannot share your excitement, Mr. Mason. Whatever changed, you have to change back. Change it back.
I'm sorry, Lucy, but Flynn is hours ahead of us. We don't have time for this.
Why not? We have a time machine, don't we?
Flynn could be decimated in history right now. Our reality could change like that any second. You need to go.
Not until we figure this out, Lucy.
Hey, you dragged her into all this. She just lost her sister. Give her a damn minute.
Flynn went back to April 14th, 1865. Now you need to get moving, and you need to eliminate Garcia Flynn. Are we clear?
What's April 14th, 1865?
The assassination of Abraham Lincoln.
Hey, I can try to figure out what happened to your sister, if you want.
Yeah.
Something happened on the Hindenburg that affected your parents somehow. I can look for a connection, you know, try to see what changed. Tell my parents' names, birthdays. Anything that can help?
You do.
Well, y'all, on top, chatter or no chatter?
Huh?
Like, if you're talking about on topic, I'm for it.
Sweet.
If you're talking, you're wearing me out, okay?
Garcia Flynn. He went straight for Anthony. He knew he was the project leader. Best of our only two pilots. So how did Flynn know so much about us, our vulnerabilities? Is there a problem? What do they do with these recordings? Why does Rittenhouse even need them? Don't speak that name out loud ever again. You're a treat. Trust me, no one is more aware than I am that I am not a real soldier. Where do these gallows even come from?
Civil War reenactors club?
No wonder they smell like sweat and loneliness. Okay,
Here, I'll move.
Sorry.
Just sit.
Where is it?
Here, let me.
I was really hoping I'd never have to get this
deal
again.
I'm sorry about
your sister. Thank you. For backing me with Agent Christopher.
Trust me. We're gonna fix it. We're gonna fix everything. You really should get some paperweights. Tell me this gets easier. It doesn't. Mr. Booth, I'm quite the admirer of yours.
Oh? What production did you see me? Which was the third?
Well, I'm not talking about a play. I know what you're about to do.
So this is where the time travelers start to interact with real people. We gotta suspend reality a little bit.
Check out that swag of
yours. Civil War just ended. Slavery's outlawed. African Americans thought their future was bright, which pretty much ends tonight when Lincoln shot.
So what do you think Flynn is up to?
He's got to be here to change the assassination.
But how?
I don't know, but I do know exactly where John Wilkes Booth is going to be. So we start there. Best guess, he takes us to Flynn.
So Booth walks into Ford's Theater at exactly 10 a.m., huh? Mm-hmm. Six, seven.
Hundreds of books have been written about those movements today.
Let me guess. You read them all.
And wrote one of them.
Why is Booth coming here now? What is he? Scouting for tonight?
No, he's an actor. He knew Ford's Theater like the back of his hand. Used it as his mailing address. Picks up his mail at exactly 10 a.m. Pretty well known, too, but his brother, Edwin, was literally the most famous actor in America. John never quite measured up.
So this is like if Donnie Wahlberg assassinated the president.
Pretty much, actually.
Come on. Hey, keep an eye out, huh? We'll find Booth or Flynn. Get us fast. Let's go. Hello. Did any of your books tell you where the mailboxes were?
No. Let's put up.
Okay. You want a second?
No, I got it.
Okay.
You all right there, Sergeant?
Yes, I am. A sergeant. I'm just fine.
What's your name?
Denzel.
Washington. I'm Nicholas. Where about you from?
Chicago.
You free when you signed up. You got Ken, the young folks still in the bunks?
No, my family was all born free.
You reading right good, huh?
Pretty good, yeah.
That's how you got them stripes. Hey, boys, get on over here. Oh, Denzel's gonna write our notices for us. We need you to write something for the newspaper. You go ahead and start with mine.
I can't write.
All right, the color Tennessee, press them free. Nicholas Biddle, 2nd Regiment, Color Infantry. That's me. Nicholas Biddle of the 2nd Regiment, Colored Infantry, wishes to learn the whereabouts of his wife and 4 children. Children are Celia, Sarah, Elizabeth, and Adam Lee. My wife's Anne. The last I seen her was in a cell pen of a human trader named Robert Clark in Atlanta.
Pardon me, miss. I'm General Grant's aide.
You're Robert Todd Lincoln.
Have we met?
No.
You too.
I admire your father.
Pleased to meet you, Miss
Juliet. Shakespeare.
Are you an actress?
No. Yes. Not a very good one. Just starting out.
Like something rarer than an actress. A modest one. General Grant was supposed to attend tonight's play. If he can't make it, then I have to return his tickets.
Well, I'll take the tickets to the box office for you.
I'd like to leave a note, too, with the General's apologies.
Of course. Take your time.
Can't attend the play because our wives don't like each other.
You know, my father's coming to the play tonight. Have you seen him?
It's not very good.
Nope. Should I tell him not to come?
Wish you could have saved him right there!
Having President Lincoln for a father, what's that like for you?
I guess it's a lone shadow. It's not one I mind living with. I'm proud of him. He's done some great things.
I agree.
And he's just getting started.
So what are you going to do once you find this land?
Work me a piece of my old master's land. I think the landowner is just going to give you his land.
Now I think President Lincoln's going to make it. All smooth sailing from here on out.
What's that supposed to mean?
I'm sorry, nothing. I didn't mean anything.
What regiment you in?
The 4th. Colored Infantry.
4th Colored, yeah. I never heard of it. What about your fight?
You fought all over
it. This ain't no real uniform. You pretending to be a soldier? Huh? After what we went through, why, say meet your girl? We're not some big hero? Hey, go on, you lying rat.
Miss Shakespeare, it has been a pleasure.
I'll see if they get it right away.
John Wilkes Booth. Robert Lincoln. I saw you on stage here last month.
Of course. Why are you here?
Well, my father invited General Grant to see tonight's play, and I'm helping him escape it. I assume you know Miss Shakespeare.
John Booth.
She's an actress.
Really? Mm-hmm. Where do you perform?
I'm new to the profession.
And very humble. Miss Shakespeare, do you know that Mr. Booth's brother saved my life on a train platform just last year? Pulled me out of the path of an oncoming train. It's a true story.
Amazing.
That's Edwin. Always the hero.
Yes, sir. The Lincolns owe the Booths great debt.
Benefit, Lord King, our American cousins, Ford's Theater.
Okay, we're 1,000% sure we can't just shoot this asshat. Save Lincoln here and now.
Believe me, I want to. It might change things too much.
Maybe there'll be a lot less lynchings. I'm serious. I just met some black soldiers. We know Lincoln's death. It's going to be a disaster for them. Not to mention my great-great-grandparents. Don't look at me. I'm with him.
Mr. Swanson?
Yes.
Look, I understand.
Swanson? Yeah.
You don't know the consequences. It's too risky. It's our job to protect this
family. Anderson, take out, right?
Well, my story sucks. Look, you know, it seems crazy, but maybe we can change things for the better.
This is the Herndon house. We're both meets with his conspirators.
What conspirators?
You run! Stay low! Don't fight for anything!
Wait, what about you?
They're behind you.
Poor digestion's all.
Oh, thank you very much, Ben.
Thank you.
Oh, where the hell is Rufus with these supplies?
You need a real doctor.
To do what? Bleach me?
Get this off me.
That's what took 15 minutes to pass back home. You're gonna die of sepsis.
You good?
Rufus, you're up. My knife's in the pocket. You gotta sterilize over the lamp.
What?
They're both still in there. It's just under the skin, but you gotta take it out.
Why me?
Because you work with your hands.
Yeah, on circuit boards.
Think of me as a circuit board. It's gonna die if you don't help.
Don't look at me. I faint.
So those weapons, finance. Why does he need that kind of firepower, huh? Lincoln gets killed anyway.
I don't think it's just about Lincoln. Lincoln's death was part of a much larger conspiracy to kill the four most powerful men in government in one fell swoop. Lincoln, Vice President Johnson, Secretary of State Seward, and General Grant. It would have been devastating, but the other shooters never followed through or just failed outright.
Well, that's before they had semi-automatic weapons.
Exactly. What if Lincoln is trying to help them succeed? They would cripple the Union, maybe revive the Confederacy. Hell, Johnson and Grant are supposed to become presidents. America, as we know it, would be unrecognizable.
Okay, so how do we stop all that?
One problem at a time. Grant takes a train out of town at 6. I need to make sure he's on it. You take care of Wyatt. We're gonna need you tonight.
This is gonna be the worst game operation ever.
Miss Jackson?
Mr. Lincoln?
What are you doing here?
Following you, it seems.
I'm a lucky man.
What happened to the train?
Technically speaking, it broke.
Oh.
Much to General Grant's dismay, he and I will be seeing pleasure.
No.
Uh-oh. History's changing.
Like I said before, it's a terrible play.
That is not what happened.
Maybe, but the General and I are already committed. But is there any chance that you'd like to see a terrible play?
What?
Excuse me for being forward, but would you come as my guest? You'd improve the evening a great deal. We've met twice in one day. That can't just be a coincidence.
We're sliding in our DMs.
Awesome. I'm at the National.
The National? It's 7.
You really have to stop meeting like this, Lucy.
You son of a bitch. My sister is gone, disappeared because of something you did to the Hindenburg.
It's war. I lost my whole family.
Because you murdered them.
Rittenhouse murdered them.
I asked about Rittenhouse and no one's ever heard of him.
Rittenhouse isn't a him, it's a they. And that's why I'm here, to right some wrongs.
By shooting a path of Washington, trying to destroy America outright.
You're trying to destroy America, I'm trying to save it. You'll see. One day, you're going to help me.
Or what? You'll kill me?
That's not a threat. It's your future. So accept it and stop trying to interfere.
What are you trying to do? What does this have to do with Rittenhouse? Tell me!
Don't get in my way again.
Some cemeteries for throw up one, you know? You went shopping.
Robert Lincoln invited me to a play.
Play? You mean the play?
General Grant's gonna be there tonight. Flynn sabotaged his train.
You saw Flynn.
I saw him leaving the train station. The point is, Grant's gonna be there tonight, and I've gotta save him.
How exactly?
I don't know. I'll get Grant out of the balcony before Booth shows up, somehow.
Okay, pretty sure we can come up with a better plan than that.
Please help.
By assuming all that, we're gonna save everybody but Lincoln?
Rufus.
All you have to do is open your mouth to save him. And you're just gonna let Booth shoot him in the head?
Do you think any of this is easy for me? My whole life, I've idolized Lincoln. When I was a little girl, I would memorize his speeches.
Or do something.
We would come back to an entirely different world. Who knows if it would be better? Or if there would be anything left to come back to at all. The present isn't perfect, but it's ours. Awful as it is, what happens to Lincoln is meant to be.
What about my wife? Because by your logic, you're saying that bad things like my wife's death are meant to be. You wouldn't use the time machine to save her either. Wow. You are saying that. So, your sister is supposed to live. My wife is supposed to die.
It's not fair.
You just lost your sister. And you're gonna sit next to Robert Lincoln and let him lose his father.
Never seen nothing like it.
Where'd you get these? We're Prussian. We make good guns.
Seek separate tyrants. The South shall be free.
Use this instead.
It's ugly.
It fires 17 bullets. You won't need the knife.
I like the knife.
Just take it.
The Derringer is more dramatic. Now, I appreciate the weapon when you provided us, sir. But I have staked my fortune and fame on this spectacle. And I will see it through as I imagine.
Mr. Robert Todd Lincoln, downstairs for Miss Statesman.
I'll be done in a minute.
Hot day.
Please, you'll save Secretary of State Seward, and you'll save Vice President Johnson.
Yeah, we got it. Lucy, just think about who you save.
Other people would when you found out that he was not the inheritor of that fortune.
Not the
air. No. People are at the wrong tree about the old man's promise. No.
He's always late.
This is true. The president did show up late in the middle of the show. He actually stopped the show to recognize his arrival.
Truly disappointed in that particular.
Yes, but we are
all...
Yes.
Miss Jackson.
I'm going to
introduce my mother, Mary, and my father, Preston. Father, please meet Julia Shakespeare.
Who's Shakespeare? How do you do? It's a great pleasure to meet you.
So, all I gotta do is save the Vice President of the United States. Sure, no probs.
Relax. The Sazerac guy shows his face. Just
point him out to the Vice President's bodyguards to do the rest.
His gun's just in case.
What if I freeze?
You won't. I grew up on the west side of Chicago in Arizona. There's this kid, Rich Tannen, who used to come after me. But I wouldn't fight. There's no fight either. I just stood there as biological. And he just beat the crap out of me. Rufus, I don't know you that well. But in the last 2 days, you helped us break out of jail. You held a knife to a Nazi's throat. You pulled a bullet out of my gut without puking. You won't freeze. I'm scared. I wouldn't go into battle with you if you weren't.
A woman of my age.
Be you a woman of your age?
Are you all right?
I'm just a little nervous.
Would you like some water? Can't allow me.
No.
This is the home of Secretary Seward. This is
the tall guy who gave you the gun. Where is he? Where is he? Nobody will always get the big guys.
Oh, my God.
Miss Shakespeare. I just need to talk to his bodyguards. I'm not trying to hurt the vice president. I'm trying to save him.
Oh, you are. Now, from what?
There's a man in here who's going to kill him.
Now, who is that? The fake sergeant said he fixed him to stop the man from killing the vice president.
Excuse me.
Been shot by John Wilkes Booth at Ford's Theater on April 14, 1865. What might be different on the very next day, April 15, 1865? What might have been different about the remainder of Lincoln's second term in office, 1865 all the way through 1868? He has a full second term in office. What might be different? The Civil Rights Movement of the 1960s and today. Take it to today, 2022. What might be different about each of those junctures? There are no wrong answers. This is a thought exercise. Next, should Lucy Preston have stopped the assassination of Abraham Lincoln? Maybe not only in the moment, but think backwards. All the moments she could have said something, changed who attended the box, all that kind of stuff. Should Lucy Preston have stopped the assassination of Abraham Lincoln? And then make it real personal. If you were a time traveler like Lucy, Wyatt, and Rufus, would you have prevented or allowed the assassination of Abraham Lincoln? Why? What is the world like today based off of your decision, personal, your decision in 1865? No wrong answers, just some deep thoughts. Spend a moment answering these questions, keeping in mind the things we've just watched. So we all really into that, and I appreciate you being right there with Lucy and Wyatt and Rufus and Robert and Ulysses and Mary Todd. You guys are right there. So spend a moment thinking about these answers. Can you quiet for a second? We will take, we'll step out just a minute early, right? We're in a flow. We're in a flow. We'll go to lunch a minute early.
It's gonna flow.
We'll go to lunch.
It's gonna flow.
You'll be fine. You'll be fine. Good evening. Good evening. Give it a fair thought here, guys. Don't rush. Give it a fair thought. No wrong answers. But I really want you to be a thinker here.
That's what I'm saying.
You can't answer your question because you weren't there.
It's like,
what? None of this happened. I don't know it.
Couple minutes, some personal reflection. We all chat with your friends, and that is fine if we're on topic.
Let me guess, you're going to kill him again.
Yeah, I got to reset and do this again before the walk.
You got another kill?
I do have some more poppers. Can I get one?
No.
Why didn't you use an earth?
No.
What?
I can put it on my red crap race.
Boom.
That's when they ended segregation. You dummy. Segregation.
Nah, this is your rank. You can't get these questions wrong. Just show me your thoughts. That would be a thing.
No wrong answers.
Where did he get shot at? Where did he get shot at when he got shot?
On his body?
That was like, yeah, his head?
Yeah.
I didn't live for like 7 hours.
Well, so it was not a high powered rifle. It was really just a slug entering his skull. Didn't step or anything. It didn't hit a sacral triangle. It's just a slow
vegetative
state.
But if somebody got shot at now today, it would have been safe.
With that type of a semi-automatic weapon, probably get some death. I know we're getting into the scenario.
I'm talking about like if it was like the gun back in the day.
Got shot with that rifle?
Yeah.
It'd be like a shotgun slug. Like a non-powerful.
But Dr. Snape, if
he got to an ER immediately, I would bet there would be a better chance, right? I can't speak to full medicine, but going to the Peterson house and just waiting it out, he's going to have a chance.
Why do they think so? If she can chant, and if she stopped him down, and it messed up some, then she could just chant.
Maybe they should have taken some medical supplies with them.
And then.
So to your medicine question, the reason they didn't want to take him to the White House or to any other medical facility is the cobblestones in the streets would have rocked his body pretty significantly, could have jarred the wound and the bullet inside of his brain. The decision was just to take him to a bed to die in peace. It was pretty understood he was going to die, that there wasn't much saving him. It's just a matter of his organs actually shutting down. I want you to see this quote from Lucy. She said it in the middle of the episode that we've already seen so far. Do you think this is easy for me? All my life I have idolized Lincoln, but we would come back to an entirely different world. Who knows if it would be better or if there would be anything to come back to at all? The present isn't perfect, but it's ours. As awful as what happens to Lincoln is, it's meant to be. So that's a little bit of her take on her job in time travel. Let's go ahead and see now how the episode finishes up.
The tall man who shot Lincoln. I saw him earlier with John Wilkes Booth whispering about something. I looked for Booth. Excuse me, officer.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Johnson?
Stewart's okay. What about?
Plane safe. But Lincoln.
He's gone.
I am so sorry.
Thank you for saving General Grant. The whole country thanks you.
I wish I could have saved your father.
There was nothing you could have done. I've become
Robert.
Yes. Okay. I'll try to have a break.
Listen, don't go south. You find your family and you head up north. It's gonna be all right.
All right? They helped us. Freed us and they killed before. It'll never get better.
It does. I promise you. It's not gonna be easy, but it does get better. Someone's back in the prison. Let's go home.
Yes, it's been some reality.
I decided I was going to let it happen. But then I called out the warning. It was too late. It's one thing to talk about history like this. Abstract thing. But when the man gets shot right in front of you.
Lincoln was assassinated by a tall, unknown gunman using an unknown gun on April the 14th, 1865.
But it's all changed. The gunman used to be John Wilkes Booth. Now it's Garcia Flynn.
The assassination was planned by John Wilkes Booth as part of a larger conspiracy. Booth was hunted down and killed. The mysterious gunman also attempted to shoot General Grant. He was saved by an obscure actress named Juliet Shakesman, never seen again. Though there is a high school in Point Pleasant, Ohio, named after her. Oh, what's it say about me? I saved Vice President Johnson. Nope, says he did. Well, that guy almost gets shot.
Well, besides the fact that we let Flynn go, it's good work. But history changed. That's not how it's supposed to be. It's close enough. Is it?
Oh my God.
What if something changed somewhere because of what we did? Maybe someone else lost their sister. Lynn didn't destroy America or the world. Take the win.
All right, let me round it out. Don't check out on me. Let me round this out. So something Lucy says right at the end there. It's one thing to talk about history like this abstract thing, but when the man gets shot right in front of you, right? She had a decision to make. I want you to remember, historians, I want you to remember we're talking about real people. We can talk about big numbers of people who died. We can talk about big events that affected families 100 years ago. And we're talking about real people. Might be far away from us today, like she says, an abstract concept, but I want you to remember we're talking about real people. Something you might think about as you finish answering your questions, the African-American soldier, he says, it'll never get better. And Rufus, who comes from the year 2017, Rufus says, it does, I promise you, it's not going to be easy, but it does get better. Obviously, a suspension of reality to talk about a time-traveling TV show. The show, again, is called Timeless. What we watched was episode 2 of season 1, episode 2. So, should you care to watch more Timeless, it's on Hulu, and there's only 2 seasons. So, it's kind of easy to watch the show. There's a lot of history infused into it. And I don't know, maybe it's just me, but I really enjoyed it. I think some of you might as well. On topic, just to finish it out, there's a movie called The Conspirator. And it talks about all the conspirators who eventually hung. And it does really focus on Mary Surratt and how difficult it was to put a woman in the gallows. Hang on. So the movie The Conspirator, also National Treasure 2, does focus on the Lincoln assassination. Lincoln movie and the book called Team of Rivals. The Ford's Theater website is fantastic. I don't know if you care to browse it, but I'm recommending it as an awesome website. And, of course, Ford Theater itself, should you ever go visit Washington, D.C. Here's what's due tomorrow. I want you to, whatever writing you didn't do, I want you to finish out your thoughts on this. I will take this up tomorrow. I will also take up what were Friday's notes. I know I said they're due today, so I'm giving you some grace. If you didn't finish out your personalities of the Civil War, you need to do that. You have to do it tomorrow. On Friday, we will be watching the movie Glory. And I am, you know, I rarely do this, but I'm going to ask for a parent signature to watch this rated R movie since we're watching the whole thing, not just the clip. So I'm going to hand you this, and I just need a parent signature. All right, I'm checking blocks here. And you can make sure you know, or your parents know, that we're going to watch this movie. Fantastic movie. I give a brief synopsis. If you'll read this and get a parent signature on it, we will watch the movie Glory on Friday and Monday. So I hope you enjoyed today. It's a little more interactive than in the past, or, you know, very interactive overall. Feel free to hit the bathroom on your way to lunch, and you are dismissed to lunch.
Mr. Swanson, we're not allowed to go anymore.
Hey, thank you for your assistance. Hey, can you video? Can you video?
I did.
Yeah,
because I want to go.
Sometimes it's there.
Yes,
Oh, how's the party?
I'm gonna jump through the window again.
I'm gonna try. Gotta get reset.